Hello everybody, welcome to Information Security 2, Cryptographic Protocols Part 2. My name is Jennifer Gabriel and today I want to give you an introduction to the field of security protocols. This lecture will cover the security in wireless networks, where we will dive into Wi-Fi security standards, especially the WPA2 and the WPA3 standard. In the second part of the lecture, I want to give you a short introduction into transport layer security with TLS and show you an application for TLS within PKI. So, let's start with the content. I assume that every one of you has at least one device in his pocket that is able to connect to other devices or the internet via Wi-Fi. For example, your smartphone or laptop may be this. Some of you may also have some devices for the Internet of Things, short IoT devices at home, like the Google Dot or the Alexa. IoT is not only a thing in private households, it's becoming even bigger in industry currently. And smart grids are some kind of IoT device. The problem with the connection of such devices via Wi-Fi is that over the air interfaces are generally spoken open. This means, without any measures taken, everyone may be able to connect to such a network. From within the network, it is easy to eavesdrop on the messages sent. Other attacks are possible as well, for example so-called rogue access points, where someone is setting up an access point with the exact same name as a network that you might already know. Then he starts to intercept the packets that you send over the rogue access point. This means the attacker may be able to read and also alter the packets. Our goal should be to prevent such and similar attacks. This can be achieved by measures like user authentication, where a user who wants to connect to a network must provide a shared secret, mostly a password, with encryption of the data transmitted within the network, and also with an authentication of the network against the client, which means that the client can verify he is connected to the network he wanted to connect to. Well-known attacks that have some history in un- or weakly secured wireless networks are, for example, MAC address spoofing, where a client uses a MAC address that is not his own to connect to the network. It is pretty simple to alter the MAC address of a device. It is done in software. And this kind of is some kind of an impersonation attack and may lead to violation of protection goals, confidentiality, integrity. Just remind the CIA triad that Alex introduced before. Replay attack is a form of a network attack in which a valid data transmission is maliciously or fraudulently repeated or delayed. Dictionary attacks are mainly used to recover encryption keys or password, for example, your Wi-Fi password. In the slide before, I already talked about the rogue access point. Packet recording and eavesdropping are pretty obvious and may be the result of, MAC address spoofing. Unwanted or unauthorized access may reveal data that should be protected. And a denial of service attack against the networks are attacks that overload the network with messages or work and therefore may lead to a complete network outage or at least render the network inperformant or unusable. The evolution of Wi-Fi security mechanisms was as follows. In 1997, Wired Equivalent Privacy, short WEP, was introduced as a ratification of the IEEE 802.11 standard. It was meant to provide access control and other features, but some researchers found out that there were some problems with it. For example, passive and active attacks, and one of the active attacks led to the decryption of the traffic within the network, which is not good at all. In 2003, the Wi-Fi Alliance, which is a non-profit organization that promotes Wi-Fi technology and certifies Wi-Fi products, introduced Wi-Fi Protected Access, WPA. It was meant to provide access control and packet encryption and includes a message integrity check, which is designed to prevent an attacker from altering and resending data packets. Researchers have since discovered a flaw in WPA that relied on older weaknesses in WEP and the limitations of the message integrity code hash function named Michael to rewrite the key stream from short packets and use for reinjection and spoofing. So not much has been better with WPA, but for the time it was better than WEP. And as you can see, it's only 1 year later that WPA2 was released, also by the Wi-Fi Alliance. WPA2 was then the final WPA. And it was used for 14 years. And after 14 years, you can imagine it was time for a new standard, because computation technologies change and so do encryption technologies. In the upcoming slides, I'm going to focus on WPA2 because it's widely used currently, and WPA3 because it's the most current standard, that the first hardware was available in 2019, and I highly recommend using this one if it's possible. So let's start with WPA2. WPA2 comes in two modes of operation. The one is WPA2 Personal, and the second is WPA2 Enterprise. WPA2 Personal is the thing most of you think will know. Every user that wants to connect to the Wi-Fi network has to provide a password. Every one of you may know the thing. You go to a friend and the first question is, hey, what's your Wi-Fi password? In contrast, WPA2 Enterprise is user authentication via backend system. It's a user management system in the backend, and every user has its own username and password. And maybe they use some sort of certificate. An example you might know is Eduroam or the University VPN. But besides this difference in how to connect to them, how to authenticate, the both modes work nearly in the same way. WPA2 provides protection against replay attacks with a 48-bit packet enumeration. This means every packet has its own number. And it introduced new cipher suites. Cipher suites are encryption methods. You can think of it like encryption methods. Alex already introduced some to you. The authentication in the network is with pre-shared key. This is usually a password. And the encryption of the transmitted data is done with AES in counter mode. The integrity check of every package is done with cipher block chaining method authentication code, short CBC-MAC. The authentication key is different from the encryption key. So you type in your password and it's used only for the authentication, but from this, an encryption key is derived that is used for the session. Now I want to explain a little what happens when we connect to a network. There is an important thing, the four-way handshake, but before we do the four-way handshake, we have to generate a pairwise master key, short PMK. And this is done by 4096 times hashing with a SHA-1 hash your password and the SSID. The SSID is usually the name, the identifier of the network. The password is the password you type in when you connect to the network. And the PMK then is used for the four-way handshake. For the four-way handshake, I just want to introduce some of the abbreviations. SDA is short for station. A station in Wi-Fi terms is the client, like your smartphone, like your laptop. The access point, AP, you know what it is. PTK is the pairwise transient key. This is a intermediate key, you can think of it. A nonce is a number only used once. Usually it's a cryptographic thing. The A nonce is the access point nonce, and the S nonce is the station nonce. MIC is the message integrity code. I talked about it before. GTK is a group temporal key. And ACK is an acknowledgement packet. So how does the four-way handshake work? The access point is sending A nonces out every time. So if you, this is how you can find the Wi-Fi network. You look at your phone, you see, okay, there is the Wi-Fi network, I want to connect to it, so you receive the anons, you type in the password, and you construct the PTK from it. What happens then is you send the SNONs, your nonce, together with the MIC to the access point. And the access point constructs from this information the PTK. It's some magic. I don't want to go too deep into this. If you are interested in this, just check the source below the picture. And then the GTK and the MIC are also sent back. As soon as the station receives that information, it verifies it and sends an acknowledgement package. And this is the moment the connection is established and every message sent via the network should be encrypted. During the 14 years of its actual use, some problems with WPA were encountered, for example, some replay attacks or cryptographic attacks against the network. But the most important attack was the crack attack. It was released in 2016 first and in 2018 again with some update. And the crack attack means that the protocol of WPA2 can be manipulated into reusing encryption keys. This means that attackers can view and compromise your encrypted traffic, inject ransomware code, hijack your credentials, and steal sensitive information like credit card numbers, passwords, emails, photos, and everything you transmit over the network. So this was the reason why WPA3 was invented. But also another problem was that it's not very usable with the ever-changing and often meshed IoT environments. And for this, I go to the next. So now we want to go to the Wi-Fi Protected Access 3. I'm going to explain you a little the new technology, what it's different, and so on. WPA3 is also a standard that was introduced by the Wi-Fi Alliance, and it has three modes of operation that are used currently. The one is WPA3 SAE, that's also known as WPA3 Personal, that's similar to the WPA2 Personal. We have WPA3 Transition. This is a new mode that it's meant to be backward compatible. If you have a new access point, for example, that provides WPA3, but your clients do not provide it, access points that come with WPA3 Transition are able to also let in devices that only speak WPA2. WPA3 Enterprise is roughly the same as WPA2 Enterprise, but with WPA3 mechanisms. WPA3 addresses the most important WPA2 problems and is optimized for better usage in ad hoc networks, what I told you before, like meshed and IoT environments. For this, I'm going to do an excursus. On the left, you see the infrastructure mode, with an access point in the middle and a lot of stations, so-called clients, around them. The access point in the middle has a clearly defined purpose. It's the access point that is managing the network. In the ad hoc mode, also called mesh networks, you don't have this instance. You don't have an access point that has this this task that to manage the network. Every station is connected to other stations directly. This is the main difference between them. And as you see, in the ad hoc network, we have to do something to make possible that the devices in the ad hoc or mesh network can connect over a secure link. In WPA2 and WPA3, the main difference is that WPA2 works with a pre-shared key, the so-called password, and WPA3 instead works with the SAE protocol, the same authentication of equals protocol. I'm going into this later. It generates a pairwise master key, so and this is a huge difference. And another huge difference is with WPA2, the role of client and access point is clearly defined. So you have the access point that's managing the network and the client that is connecting to the network. And in WPA3, all participants of the network are equal, so there is no managing instance. You can think about it like going to a club. In WPA2, you go to the club door, the doorman asks you for your ID, you pass him the ID and he lets you in. In WPA3, it's a little bit different. You go to the club, but you make sure that you go to a specific club. You make sure this is the club I want to go to. And you also make sure that the doorman is a doorman that belongs to the club. And then you show him your ID. So this is roughly the difference. Now I'm talking a little bit more about the simultaneous authentication of equals, short SAE. The initial definition was in IEEE 802.11s, which is the standard for mesh networks or ad hoc networks. It is a variant of the Dragonfly protocol. I think it's important that you heard of the Dragonfly protocol on this topic. It provides mutual authentication, so you don't go to the club, show your ID. You go to the club, make sure that you go to the right club, and then you find out if the doorman belongs to the club. So it also uses a PAKE, a so-called password authentication key exchange, which is based on a zero-knowledge proof. A zero-knowledge proof is a proof that makes sure that both parties know a common secret, but no one has to send the secret over to the other party. We send over something that shows the other party we know the common secret, but not the secret itself. The SAE is close to the Diffie-Hellman key exchange. The DHKE, and Alex already introduced it to you, but it adds an authentication element to the DHKE, but I don't want to go too deep into that. Details of this. It allows the operation with modp groups and elliptic curves, and this relies on the security of the discrete logarithm problem. The discrete logarithm problem is a mathematical problem that is easy to compute but very hard to revert. The SAE protocol consists of three phases. The first phase is the key derivation phase, then it goes over into the commit phase, and then into the confirm phase. In the key derivation phase, we generate a group element PE, which is derived from the pre-shared password, the password we type in when we connect to the network, and from an elliptical curve E and a prime P we already agreed on before. So the PE goes then into the commit phase and leads to the generation of two values, a scalar and an ephemeral key. This is something like an intermediate key that is just used for further computation. These values are sent to the other party in a so-called commit message. The other party then verifies the received data, and from the received data, a unique session key is generated. The unique session key that is generated is the same on both ends, and it provides forward secrecy, something Alex already also introduced to you before. Our unique session key is then taken and goes into the four-way handshake. The four-way handshake is the same four-way handshake we had before in the WPA2, but now in the WPA2 we took the pre-shared key, the PRS master key of the pre-shared key, and put it into the four-way handshake. But now we take the session key that was derived of the SAE protocol and take it and put it into the four-way handshake. Unfortunately, there are already well-known security problems with WPA3. For example, there is a denial of service attack, a downgrade attack, dictionary attacks, and timing attacks against some of the elliptic curves. So not every elliptic curve is ready to use. But most of the problems got fixed by vendors, not all of them. But even if there are existing problems with WPA3, WPA3 is more secure than WPA2, and I highly recommend you to update or upgrade to WPA3 if it's possible for you. This was it with the WPA, And then we go over to transport layer security. Now I want to give you a short introduction into TLS, transport layer security. Another topic that is very important in this environment is HTTPS. And the question is, how can traffic on the internet be secured? And how can it be implemented so that all parts of the application, for example, a web application that consists of the web browser and the backend server, can make sense out of what is happening there? And therefore, we use TLS, Transport Layer Security, as the cryptographic protocol, and HTTPS, its hypertext transfer protocol secure. This is a specific implementation of TLS with a public key infrastructure, and a public key infrastructure is abbreviated with PKI. Well-known applications for TLS that most of you may know is web browsing the web, like going to Facebook, Google, everything, doing online banking, writing emails, doing instant messaging, and voice over IP. So TLS provides us a secure connection from the client to the server. It's important from the client to the server, for example, from our web browser to the server of Facebook or something. If you use TLS, the connection is secured. Its deprecated predecessor is the secure socket layer, or SSL, and sometimes you will read SSL/TLS. This means that you are secure. The most current version of TLS is the version 1.3, and TLS is asymmetric cryptographic protocol, Alex introduced, that provides communication security. But how is the key exchanged? This is a question I will answer later. But now, just for first, the process flow of a TLS handshake. In a TLS handshake, the client says, "Hello, I can communicate securely, for example, over AES." There are other cryptographic suites that can be used, but let's just assume we do AES. Then the server answers, "Oh, hey, I also communicate securely through AES, so let's do this." What the server then does is another message who sends the server key exchange. And in general, this is the digital certificate. He's sending the digital certificate to the client, and the client says, "Oh, cool, I see you have a digital certificate. So now this is now a new master key." This is done also with the Diffie-Hellman key exchange. So you see, it's a very important protocol in cryptography. And then both change the cipher specification and begin a secure communication. After this, the encrypted handshake is taking place. So this is the first encrypted message. And it states, now we are talking encrypted. And if every party can decrypt this message, the ongoing communication is also encrypted. This is roughly what happens with TLS in the handshake. To have a good idea of how the key exchange is working, I want to introduce you to PKI, that's public key infrastructure. A public key infrastructure is usually a trusted hierarchy used for asymmetric encryption. And for this, you need a certificate authority, that's abbreviated CA. That's mainly a trusted third party, that's mostly companies, and you pay them to generate a certificate for you. They verify the owner of the certificate, if the owner is really the person or the company who states it is. And most of the certificates that are signed by a certificate authority are included in browsers or even the operating system and are pre-installed. But sometimes some of the certificates need to be installed by yourself. For example, with the EduRoam or University VPN, you may have encountered this. So now let's look what happens when we have a certificate authority in addition to our TLS handshake. The TLS handshake is running in completely the same way. We have, "Hello, I can communicate over, let's say, AES again." The server answers with, "Okay, that let's do it," and sends us the certificate. But what happens now is that the client is taking the certificate and it's checking the integrity against the pre-installed certificate. There are serial numbers and so on, and so the client can check if it's the same. And if it's the same, he goes on, like before, with, hey cool, here's our new master key, and so on. So we have the same procedure, but now we check if the certificate is the certificate we are waiting for. And now let's go into HTTPS, which is Hypertext Transfer Protocol Secure, as I told before. This is Hypertext Transfer Protocol over SSL or TLS. This is a TLS which uses a PKI, and this provides confidentiality, integrity and authenticity all of the CIA across a connection. So the main question is how to see if I'm connected to another website when I'm going with my web browser, for example to Facebook. How can I see if I'm connected via HTTPS, and how does it look if something is really fishy? So if everything goes the way we expect, in the Firefox you see the lock, the closed lock, and the HTTPS before the www of the application you want to go through. In Chrome or Chromium, you just see the closed lock. They do not show the HTTPS for some reason. I don't know why. If something is really, really fishy, you will get an error message like this one. I'm pretty sure you all have seen this before. And if you get such an error message, I highly recommend you to not browse to the website, except you absolutely know what you are doing. So just don't go to that website. So we are close to the end of this lecture. And so a short recap. I talked to you about Wi-Fi security. I introduced some attacks. I introduced Wi-Fi security standards, especially WPA2 and WPA3, and the difference between the two. I introduced to you the four-way handshake, which is a central part of WPA2 and 3. And later, I introduced to you TLS and its applications, as well as a PKI, a public key infrastructure, CAs and the certificates. If you are interested in the topic, I added some links for further reading. And if you like to go deeper into the security, we are offering various options for thesis, students' thesis, bachelor's thesis, masters and diplomas. Just reach out to us and we will find something that suits you. Bye!